All right, welcome. So my name is Joshua Corman. I'm on the RSA program committee. I'm also a founder of a nonprofit cyber safety advocacy group called IamTheCavalry.org. And one of the reasons we wanted to bring this to you is we tend to be very focused on the near-term, immediate horizon. We're very reactionary as an industry out of necessity. But some of these issues require us projecting 2, 3, 5 years into the future so that we get the technology we want, not react to the technology we wish we had. So one of the problem statements that unified us to do the cyber safety advocacy was that our dependence on connected technology was growing much, much faster than our ability to secure it, especially in areas affecting public safety and human life, like connected vehicles, medical devices, critical infrastructure, and the Internet of Everything. But in addition to, once we get that figured out and sorted and we can actually secure these things better, now that we can do anything with technology, what should we do with technology? And what we're realizing is the ultimate governor is, do we have the right social contracts, ethics, legal frameworks, and understand the relationship that we want between technology and the human condition? So RSA really wanted to challenge you and bring some world experts together to try to tease out where should we be in 2 to 5 years, because honestly, for the car industry, for example, the 2019 models are already built. So anything we decide today may not manifest for quite some time. And given those long lead times, it's really important that we tackle this today. So we've assembled a very colorful and brilliant panel for you today. Starting with our moderator, please raise your hand. Welcome the Wired Magazine senior maverick and author of the upcoming book, The Inevitable, Kevin Kelly. All right. We also have a leading artificial ethicist, Patrick Lynn. I've loved the writing on what should your car kill you. So please welcome Patrick Lynn. Author of Humans Need Not Apply, artificial intelligence expert Jerry Kaplan. And Silicon Valley lawyer Stephen Wu. And we'd like... So without further ado, let's dive into the impact of driverless cars in society, economy, security, and the world we want. Thank you.
Thank you. So thank you for the introduction. And we're here to talk about something that will become more common in the coming years. It revolves around the fact that artificial intelligence is already here, and it's already changing things. And once we have really smart things that make their own decisions, we have to start to think about the consequences of those. And if you haven't been paying attention, AI is moving very, very fast. It's beat a world master Go player, which thought was for a long time not going to happen. Of course, it's winning and playing and learning how to play video games. And the poster boy of AI right now is the fact that it can learn how to drive a car. And so we are talking about cars mostly because this is the place that we can see some of these challenges. But what we want to emphasize is that AI will have a role in cybersecurity. It will have a very large role. Anytime you have a large amounts of data and humans, AI is going to play a very important role. So the things that we're talking about, even though we're talking about cars, they're really about any kind of large data set these days as we apply intelligence and smartness to it. So the issues that we're kind of wrestling with about cars is just a toy example of something even bigger that will apply to AI, data sets, security, cybersecurity, all these things are involved. So we're going to try and amplify that a little bit to show that it does concern what the major theme of today is. So what we thought we would do is to try and make it concrete and take two scenarios and kind of play with them and let the three experts talk about what this scenario suggests to them. We'll do one scenario and then a second scenario. And the first scenario is kind of along the expected questions of, say, car safety and accidents. But that's not the only thing that understanding the ethics of decisions is about. It's not just about accidents. There's a lot of other issues that we hope to kind of explore in the second scenario. So I think what I'll do is I'll read this scenario. It's just a few lines, and then have these guys sort of tease it apart. So the scenario is pretend that our job right now is to work for a manufacturer of some of these autonomous vehicles. And the CEO has been reading about news headlines that talk about the cars having to decide who to kill. And the idea is a kind of a old philosophical conundrum called the trolley problem. And the CEO is hearing about this trolley problem. And the trolley problem, very briefly, is a scenario that a car or a robot car, an autonomous car, is going along and it has to make a decision whether to take control of the human driver who's about to plow into either five people, or if it swerves, it will actually run down one other person, a pedestrian, say. So that person or the car now has to make a decision about who to hit, who to kill. In other words, the circumstances are such that the car has to make a decision one way or the other, which decision does it make? And the engineers who are programming this kind of have to think about that now. They have to kind of make this decision now about something that may happen in the future. So the CEO is saying, do I need to take this seriously? Is this just a hypothetical, or do I need to really think about this? Do we really need to decide right now? And so he's called these guys before him to say, what about it? Is this a serious problem, or is this just some imaginary problem? So, Patrick, you've thought about this a little bit. What do you think?
So if we're in this imaginary scenario, we're giving advice to the CEO, I would say, yeah, these are rare scenarios. I mean, they might never happen in the real world, but that doesn't matter. So these are thought experiments. They're not meant to simulate reality. They're meant to isolate your design principles so you could stress test them. So a thought experiment is like a science experiment. So for instance, NASA sends spiders into outer space to test how they spin webs in zero gravity. Scientists give spiders drugs, marijuana, cocaine, acid. These things don't happen in nature. You know, at least we hope they don't, right? There aren't any spiders in outer space. They're not high on crystal meth. But they're still important experiments because they're able to isolate variables like gravity, which you can't do in the real world. That's what we're doing with thought experiments. We're creating artificial setups that might never exist in the real world, but we can learn something from them, right? We could isolate, laser in on the basic design principle. So what's your design principle? Is it to save as many lives as possible? Is it to always obey the law? Is your design principle to always protect the user at all cost? So if we could isolate the design principles, we could really study them, see where they break, see where the edge cases are.
Okay. So, Steve, what do you think about this? Should we take this seriously?
We need to take this seriously. I am acting today in the scenario as the role of the general counsel of the company. I'm here to provide legal advice to the CEO. And what I would say is, just as the philosophers have thought experiments, in law school, we have hypotheticals. We need to understand what would happen in specific scenarios. And the fear that I have, and the thing that I address people with on autonomous vehicles, is the concern that liability, perhaps catastrophic liability, will cause auto manufacturers not to enter the market of autonomous vehicles or to leave the market for autonomous vehicles. We may have catastrophic collisions because of autonomous vehicles, and we may have litigation that results from it. Lawsuits that are class actions that perhaps will cause liability that could bankrupt certain defendants. But the message that I would tell the CEO is that today is the time for you to prepare for a case that hasn't happened yet, because the accident hasn't happened. By being prepared today to design the product safely, and not only safely, going beyond what needs to be done as a minimum standard of safety, you can prepare today to win the case of tomorrow before the accident occurs.
So, Jerry, yesterday Google autonomous car had an accident with a bus. Should we have been thinking about this already? Is this something that we're overdue with?
Well, they're certainly thinking about it. They just hit a bus.
Okay.
But it seems to me that there are two fundamental ways in which we want to think about this problem. The first one's at the ethical level, and I'm a student at the feet of Patrick on the ethics of this issue. The other one is at a practical level. And maybe I could just take a second to try to sharpen up our intuitions about the ethical level. It would seem obvious in the way that you framed the problem, by the way, that it's the trolley problem, because back when philosophers first started thinking about it, all they had were trolleys, to give you an idea how old this concept is. The way you framed the problem was a choice between killing one person and five people. Obviously, you want to kill one person if you have that choice. But what if you own that car, and you're the one person who happens to be sitting in the car, and there are five people? I don't think anybody would fault you for not committing suicide if you were driving and endangering the lives of five other people. So when we go to sell real cars in the model that we have today of people buying and owning cars, that car is your agent, and you expect it to be acting in the ways in which you would act. So it's very important to understand that these can become selling points for cars. Do you want to set the ethical standard to Mother Teresa or to Kim Kardashian? You know, these are the kinds of things. And they'll be selling the cars based upon how aggressive it's going to be to protect you at the expense of other people. So let me give you another example. Suppose we have a public fleet of such cars, and they're driving around, and you hire a car Uber style, and you get into it. Well, now I think the intuition is very different. We certainly wouldn't expect, think of these as public utilities. Like if you're on a train, that you want them to, the car that you're in to try to kill the people in the other car on the train so that you save your life. So the point is that who owns the vehicle and whose interests it's supposed to represent affect our ethical calculus as to what's up. Now, on the practical level, it's all about liability. I don't think the CEO really cares that much unless it's a question of whether they will be held responsible for errors that might take place. And I personally believe that this will be driven by the insurance industry. As long as you're insured, there's far less concern about, at a practical level, whether exactly the way in which the car currently is.
There might be a practical level in the sense that if you have this one car company and you're trying to choose between two car companies, and this one car company has decided that the driver is always preferred, the driver's life is more valuable than the pedestrian's, you might practically decide to buy that brand car. So it does have some effect on your buying decisions, because the policies, the ethical policies of the different brands might make a difference to you as a driver.
There's also a legal aspect too, right, which is that from a consumer protection standpoint, the law prefers the consumer, meaning the owner of the car, not the pedestrian who's outside of the equation of the selling. So when you had, for example, the Toyota sudden acceleration litigation, one of the major forms of liability for Toyota was not that there were accidents, it was because the car wasn't worth what the purchaser bought it at. It was worth less because of this vulnerability in the car. So consumer protection laws change the calculus and favor the owner over the pedestrian.
And to I quibble with your example, yes, if you're an individual buying the car for yourself, right, that's one thing. If you're the work for the city of San Francisco and you're responsible for maintaining the fleet, you're not going to choose the car that kills an occupant.
Right.
I get that backwards.
Right.
In response, you're going to do the one that creates the greatest good in your judgment for the entire group.
Yeah. So Pat, what haven't we said about the complexities of this question?
Well, it's a common assumption that people aren't going to buy cars that might potentially sacrifice themselves. Okay, it's a common assumption, it's reasonable, but I'm not sure how that's going to play out. So for instance, most of us fly, we get on airplanes. There's some conditions under which the US military will shoot down your airplane, right, if you're being hijacked. We all know this. We all go into an airplane knowing that there's a tiny, tiny chance that for the greater good, our lives might be sacrificed. Not the case in Germany, they have different laws and constitution, but it definitely is here in US and a lot of places. So I think, I suspect that might be an overblown worry. I mean, if it's explained that, look, these cars are programmed for the greater good, for the public good, we're valuing that little kid, a pedestrian, that little kid on a bike, maybe under some circumstances more than you, I think everyone can understand that. So it's an empirical question, and I think we need to do more research and surveys on consumer preferences. It's a common assumption, but I think it might be premature.
From a legal perspective, the consumer protection laws would say we don't want defeated expectation. If you are a consumer and you're expecting a car to protect you and you were surprised to find out it doesn't, it protects the pedestrian instead, those expectations are defeated and you might sue the manufacturer. But equally, if the car were advertised as something that would do something for the greater social good and protect those pedestrians, and you bought that car on that basis, your expectation might be defeated if it went the other way and protected you over that pedestrian.
Well, isn't it also the case that how we view these things may change over time? And I think that we're going to find that there will be a best practices. There will be an accepted standard, and that will arise out of industry groups and government. It's just, you know, like the National Highway Transportation
Traffic Safety Administration.
Yeah. I mean, so, you know, the CEO is in some sense responsible, each CEO in making a different decision. There'll be some kind of industry standard that will arise, and if the machine, in this case the car, adheres to that standard, that's acceptable risk for society.
We will definitely have different social mores as time goes on, but in addition, expect to see potential legislation in this area where we can talk about, in the context of Congress or a state legislature, what ought to be done with setting the rules on these cars.
Exactly. Yeah.
So if we were to try, again, to kind of raise this a little bit broader, not just about cars, but thinking about sort of other kinds of systems and even security systems, and what would be the analog in kind of a cybersecurity way in which the ethics might have an issue in terms of engineering in ethical decisions?
Well, let me think a little bit about the analog, but let me point out something that might be relevant,
okay,
which is that when people talk about driverless cars, we look at big benefits. Hey, it's going to save a lot of lives, right? More than 30,000 people a year die on U.S. roads because of car accidents. That's like this RSA conference number of people every year die. But on one hand, they say these big social benefits, but on the other hand, if you're gonna say, well, manufacturers are gonna have to set their cars to prefer saving their owners' lives over everyone else, there's a big tension there between the advertised good and what you think is needed to sell. And again, I'm not sure that you need to have a selfish car, like a Donald Trump model car, okay, since we brought up Kim Kardashian, which doesn't sound like a bad model. I need a lot of trunk space in my car. but if you have a car that values your life uber alles, right, I think there's an ethical problem there. I mean, that's a selfish car. And that's a root of a lot of social problems because we are selfish, right, that we look at only after our own interests. And if we could all expand from that a little bit and think about others around us, maybe with some industry setting, then I think we can get to a better place.
Well, Kevin, you raised this in the, is there a corollary in security? And the answer is absolutely yes, and I don't really hear it being talked about. It is in your interest for the NSA to collect everybody else's data, but it is not in your interest to have the NSA collect your data. That can only hurt you. So we already make these kinds of collective decisions, or I shouldn't say that. These decisions are made for us by people at an agency whose name cannot be spoken. And these are the same kinds of ethical issues. The current thing going on with Apple is a wonderful example of this. I don't want the government to be able to get into my phone, but I would like them to have the capability to get into everybody else's phone in case that might affect my safety in some way.
And so also in the car arena, again, there's not just accidents is not the only thing where the ethics might have a role. There might be another example where if you have a car that's driving itself, it might be programmed to drive by a certain store or something that might tempt you in some ways. Maybe it's a food store. And the question is that a okay thing to do? Is that an ethical thing? Do we have any say? Is there some way for us to think about that now? So Patrick.
Yeah, I think a lot of industries will be challenged. This isn't just about shiny robot cars. This is about broader AI, and there's a huge ecosystem of cottage industry supporting all this. So for instance, we can imagine in the future, your autonomous car might have an in-car app from Yelp, and on autonomous mode, it might drive you past an advertiser, right? It might say, hey, there's a 4-star restaurant over here, it's 6 o'clock, I see you haven't eaten yet, let me go ahead and take you by that. So what are the ethics of, you know, this sounds like a mini hijacking, really, if you don't like it. So what are the ethics of you know, being driven by your app? There are other concerns with in-car apps, privacy, cybersecurity, and you're right, it goes far beyond crash dilemmas and life and death dilemmas. We have to think of things like, in the future, how do cities get their tax revenue if they can't write speeding tickets anymore? How do people get donated organs if no one dies on the road? So I'm not saying that we should stop this technology to save people who need organ donations, but we have to be prepared that these are disruptions that are going to happen, and we have to think about how to manage them.
Jerry.
Well, the example that you gave, which was, I'm sorry, I'm losing.
The example was driving by.
To me, the issue is one of disclosure more than anything else. This is just like having an advertising version of your site, or you can pay a little money and the ads go away. So, I mean, they'll be faced with, the consumer decision is very simple. If you want to go directly from the best route from point A to point B, that's going to cost you X. And if you're willing to let the car offer to make a stop at Target on the way for 5 minutes, your trip is free and Target's going to pay for it, even if you don't buy anything.
You know, from a legal perspective, what we're talking about is providing people with notification of the behavior of the car and then providing them with an opportunity to agree to it or not.
Right.
So transparency is important, not lying is important, not trying to conceal things, not trying to cover things up. If we had the notice and people assented to that kind of behavior of driving past the restaurants, then there wouldn't be a problem from a consumer law perspective.
But how likely is that going to happen? I mean, none of us reads the terms and services of any of our apps, right? A couple of years ago in Massachusetts, there's a case where a guy signed up for a Google Plus account, and his Google Plus account automatically emailed everyone invitations. Turns out one of the persons that was emailed an invitation was his, I think, ex-fiancee, who had a restraining order out on him. So that guy got arrested for something he didn't know what was gonna happen, he didn't intend to do. So think, now connect this back to robot cars. What if your robot car drives you someplace that you're not supposed to be at, right? Maybe you're a recovering alcoholic, it takes you by bars because you Yelp advertisers, where you have a restraining order out. I mean, there's about a million active restraining orders out right now in the US. There are a lot of people who shouldn't be around other people. What if your car takes you around them through no fault of your own? Who's liable? You or the manufacturer or your car? So, I mean,
It becomes complicated, and, you know, from a restraining order perspective, you have a good defense to a complaint that you were somehow acting in contempt of the court's order.
So I want to raise another issue, which is a little more technical. So one of the things that we're discovering about AI and these systems that we make is that some of these systems are so complicated that, in fact, they make decisions in ways that we don't understand and therefore can't even change very well. So there was actually a little bit of a brouhaha at Google because the main Google search guy kind of left because Google's algorithm for favoring certain things in search was actually at the point where they couldn't understand it and therefore they couldn't really manage it. And some people were really adamant and like, no, we need to be able to control this. And others were saying, no, the beauty or the power of this comes when we actually don't even understand what it does. So how successful are we going to be in actually trying to bring these ethics into these systems when a lot of it is operating in a level where we don't even have understanding about it? And I know you've probably thought about this.
Well, sure. Have you ever used a computer? I mean,
yes,
come on.
I have.
Yeah, so, I mean, you talk about machines that don't do what you want them to do and that are inscrutable. Obviously, we're very accustomed to this. And to me, it's bad design. It's just that simple. If it's transparent, if it's clear, if you understand it, if it's doing things that are consistent with what you want, I think that's perfectly good. Will the cars be making decisions you don't understand? God, I hope so. You certainly don't want to be sitting there reviewing it. Your car today is making decisions. When you step on the brake, your ABS system, if I got the right term.
ABS, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, it's deciding which wheel to lock and which not to lock in order to keep your car going as straight as possible. Now, let me point out there's an ethical problem with ABS, since I'm going down a rat hole here, I may as well continue. The problem is this, it will keep your car going straight and bring you to a halt. But it turns out on certain surfaces, icy or snowy surfaces, it takes longer to stop than it does if you just locked all of the brakes and let the car spin around. So there are circumstances where there might be a child playing in the street in the snow, and the right thing to do is to lock the wheels and let you spin around and save that child's life, but your car decided otherwise. So these decisions, if they had pitched ABS as, now you have the skills of a professional driver at your command, we'd all be talking about the ethics of it. Instead, what we have is it's simply pitched as part of the way the car is designed to help you. We're not conscious of, it's not disclosed, and you're not aware of the fact that your car today may make a decision that causes a human death contrary to what your intentions are.
So, Pat.
Yeah, but I think the difference there, and I think what Kevin's getting at is, that's a scenario where the outcome is predictable. You can predict what ABS is going to do.
You repeat it.
It's repeatable. But I think what you're talking about is you have so much complexity in AI that is just unpredictable. That means the risks are unknown, right? There's unknown unknowns. And do you field a product with that much uncertainty? It's one thing if you field a office document that might have some bugs. You know, it's one thing if that crashes. It's another thing when a robot car crashes, right? 2 tons of steel and glass driving at 60 miles an hour next to your family's and mine. I mean, the stakes are a lot higher. So it's a good question. In the killer robots debate, so I work in this debate too with the United Nations and others, there's a strong feeling that fully autonomous killer robots are unethical because exactly they lack meaningful human control. That in any important decision, a human being ought to be accountable. A human being ought to know what's going to happen and make that decision. Now, if you say autonomous cars are unpredictable in bad life-impacting ways, not just ABS ways, well, to that, maybe to some other degree, you might run up against the same issue of meaningful human control. Critics, consumers, they might demand meaningful human control, and if manufacturer can't guarantee that, if they can't predict or foresee all these different boundary conditions, then that might be a problem.
Well, I'm thinking of a little bit more generally in the sense that, again, not in terms of, say, accidents, but AIs, big data, It's very possible that, say, a mortgage AI, an AI that's actually allotting mortgages, could itself become racist, okay? And we would look at the code and we wouldn't be able to know why, because it's doing things, it's making decisions. And so the question, and of course, and then the same thing in cybersecurity, you could have a cybersecurity system that's profiling or keeping some people out. And you don't have any good explanation about why, because its algorithm and its processes are actually obscure to us. So what kind of power do we have in bringing the kind of writing the ethics for the system when we may not even understand how it works?
I think as part of the due diligence for acquiring an AI system, you as an enterprise, say, acquiring a system like that, you're going to want to understand how it works, because you bear risk if you purchase this and use it in a way that creates liability. So for example, right now, this is a real issue where employers are using AI programs to sort through resumes, and we're worried about this possibility of bias in the algorithms used to sort through resumes. So the purchasers of those systems should be doing their due diligence on these programs to say, tell me exactly how this works. Tell me exactly what are the factors that go into making these decisions. And if there are possible biases, then those customers are going to say to the manufacturers, you need to change the way that this is working. They will assert that control.
And the issue is, just to be clear, the issue is that right now the most powerful ones we cannot understand. We cannot get that list of things. And that's the issue that we're headed into.
Yeah. Well, Kevin, you're correct, but I think you're drawing the wrong conclusion, okay, if I may say. It's true that these systems may work in unpredictable ways as far as you can't give a good explanation for why something happened. But to me, you're talking to the wrong audience. It's an engineering problem. Saying, look, you can't give a mortgage company a machine learning system that optimizes revenue without considering whether you're using race, religion, or forget the third thing, is illegal. It's just a design problem. This is a bad product. It doesn't fit the spec. Now, when we think of it as, oh my God, AI is magic, then we run afoul of not the, looking at it as a practical matter as to what we really need to do. And it just means it's bad technology, it's not going to be useful for that purpose, and it's not some law of nature that we have to use it. We're just saying that's a flaw in those kinds of systems.
And I think this speaks to the need to do a lot of testing, a lot of testing. I know a lot of people are having problems with companies such as, you know, Tesla and others. They're beta testing their cars on public roads, right? So they're ironing out the kinks in real life, not in a lab, not in a closed environment, but on city streets. I think when Tesla unrolled their autopilot feature, and was it October, November, it didn't take a day before YouTube videos came up of near accidents. I mean, so there's a line where your corporate experiments turns into human subjects research. And human subjects research is usually governed by strict oversight and ethics boards. And we don't have that in industry. So the whole idea of AI complexity, I think, give rise to these sort of issues. At some point, when you experiment your products, and your products are social, or they interact with people, and they could directly harm people, then you have to be very careful there. You may be crossing the line between simple A-B testing and human subjects research.
And that's why when you have a discussion about the California autonomous vehicle regulations that were proposed by the Department of Motor Vehicles, what they say is that a human still has to be behind the wheel, ready to take control if need be.
Yeah, Jerry.
Can I just say, I think that's one of the silliest things ever. I'm sure we're gonna be selling little mechanical hands that fool the wheel. As soon as you have a car that can get on a highway and take you to work, you're gonna be in the backseat taking a nap, even if they say you've gotta hold on to the wheel. And what this is all about, let's be serious about it. It's about the manufacturers trying to offload to you, foist off onto you a bunch of risks because they don't know how to deal with it. Just because your car thinks it's in a dangerous situation and a little light goes off and it goes beep, you take over, you know, you're now in charge. It's obviously a bad solution. It's called the handoff problem. And that's a failure of the technology, and it's a result.
I think they see that as they don't feel like the technology is good enough to trust yet.
Absolutely, it's scapegoating, though.
It's they're scared of it.
Right, here, you take it.
Yeah.
You know, the bomb's about to go off, you take it.
The National Highway Traffic Safety Administration took a different tack and said that for purposes of who's the driver of the car, the autonomous system can be the driver of the car. So in a letter from the council from NHTSA, that's what the lawyer said. So we have a possible conflict between NHTSA and the California Department of Motor Vehicles.
So let me just switch to the second scenario, just to kind of work on the conclusion. And so the second scenario says, let's pretend that we are policymakers in DC and that we're looking at this issue, which we've just brought up, of autonomous vehicles and how they should be regulated. And so what we're saying is, besides these specifics, what kind of counsel should we get as a policymaker in DC? What kinds of things haven't we mentioned so far should we be thinking about in the larger arena? One of the ones you mentioned is who's liable. That's one thing, but that's not the only question. What are some of the other bigger issues that we have with these very large systems, like a driverless car, but also like a cybersecurity system, which is a very big system? What are some of the issues that we should be thinking about in terms of ethics?
Well, I'll take that one.
Yeah.
I'd like to make a point that we're focused on the ethics. As Patrick points out, these are extremely rare edge cases in all likelihood. The real problem is this technology has great promise and the opportunity to save thousands and thousands of lives. The most likely reason that it will not get rolled out and will not save those lives is not ethical issues. It's what I would call the social integration into the way in which we currently operate cars in society. It's people are going to object when the cars butt into line, or they steal your parking spot, or they engage in all kinds of behavior because we have a lot of implicit understandings of how people behave when they're in cars. And in fact, that was the cause of the Google accident. I don't think we have time to go into that. But the problem is we need to stop thinking about this as just we're engineering this gadget and we're gonna let it loose in this environment. We need to be thinking about the whole environment and the social environment. By way of historical example that people would be familiar with, the Segway is a great thing, and they thought everybody would be riding around on Segways in cities. But there was backlash about the use of the sidewalks. Dead. That's exactly the kind of problems that we're going to have. These cars can tailgate you at 60 miles an hour, probably 2 feet behind you, much more safely than any human driver, of course, would never be able to do that. But how are you going to feel when you're in that car and a car gets right in behind you and it's 2 feet behind you and you're, you know, and there's no driver in it?
Or to steal your job, right? I mean, you've got the problem of taking jobs away from
absolutely. And the effects, Patrick alluded to this, there's a very broad context in which we have to look at this. It may decimate the car industry because we're only going to need a tenth as many cars. Parking lots will be, it's like manufacturing real estate because you can circulate these cars as opposed to have them park right near where you want to be. It's going to, the parking industry, I mean, you just go down this list, the healthcare industry, it's going to devastate a lot of these industries. And the positive is it's likely to add $1 to $2 trillion a year to the U.S. economy. That's not small potatoes. But we need to be thinking as policy, not about, well, it's just the way it is now, but instead of a driver, we put the automated car. We need to be thinking about how does that change our society? What are the social impediments to how these types of technologies will be rolled out? Because we can make the wrong decision for perfectly good reasons.
And think about unintended consequences. There are many possible social effects. There are possibilities that people will want to spread out further away from the city centers because they can do a two-hour commute while they're sleeping, and then we'll have super sprawl. There are all kinds of unintended effects that we haven't even begun to think about.
Sure. I mean, some of the people, just to throw a few of these out, Patrick, you may have other examples. Like, what's it going to do? Now you can go out drinking all night and not worry about getting home because your car can drive you home. It's going to affect alcoholism. It's going to affect the beer industry. I mean, these are the kinds of issues that we're going to deal with.
I think, Jerry, you're right. So I think it's a mistake to think that what we're doing here is building a better car. That's like saying that electricity makes a better candle, right? There are some wide repercussions. It's going to change industries. You know, we talked about advertising already, for instance. We have to be careful also not to overblow expectations. I already mentioned one example. On one hand, people say, well, these autonomous cars are going to save a ton of lives. On the other hand, no manufacturer really cares about that. They want to sell a car that sells. And a car that sells might be a car that guards your life jealously. So we have attention there. A lot of people say that autonomous cars will give mobility to senior citizens who can't drive and handicapped folks, and it will send my kid to soccer games. I don't need to watch a boring soccer game. But I think we're not going to see that for a long, long time. I mean, these cars need to be able to drive themselves 100% of the time, not 99% of the time, not 99.99% of the time, but 100% of the time. Because if there is that one chance that the car needs the user to jump in and intervene, well, a blind person isn't going to be able to do that. An unlicensed person isn't going to be able to do that. So we have to be careful of how we sell this technology because we could oversell it or undersell it. If I could mention one thing about insurance, a lot of people think that an insurance company will just go under given these ultra-safe cars. I think it can go the other way. I mean, as we have flash crashes in the stock market a lot now, we might have a flash crash if all the cars were connected.
You could have a single point of failure where a single vulnerability, if exploited, could cause a cascading failure of systems and cause mass accidents.
Yeah. So you have to think about new businesses as well as new business models. Insurance companies, maybe, instead of selling premiums 6 months at a time, you might be able to do insurance on a real-time metered basis. So before I get in my autonomous car, oh, I see you've been drinking. Well, that's going to raise your insurance rate, a couple of dollars. Accept? Yes or no? Oh, I see you're driving late at night. It's going to insure, or you're parking in a bad neighborhood. It's going to raise your insurance rate a little bit. Accept, yes or no? So I think the insurance company could survive, and a lot of these other companies that are threatened with disruption, but they're going to need to be creative about it.
Let me quibble a little bit with Patrick on one minor point, if I may, which is these things don't have to substitute one for one 100% of the time for regular human-driven cars. In fact, that's going to prevent. They'll put it out another 20, 25 years at least, if ever. What you really want to do is to make minimal and reasonable changes to your infrastructure to accommodate them. Today, I might drive down to the train station and get on the train to go somewhere. Well, maybe that model continues, the last mile problem. Maybe I call an Uber and take it 1 mile down to a depot with a human driver, and then I get into a car that's designed to get on a specialized ramp onto the highway. There's a specialized lane, and I think these are the kinds of infrastructural changes that will make sense. When cars were introduced in New York City in the very early 1900s, there was a tremendous backlash because all the streets, they didn't have lanes, and the streets were designed for a certain class of social interaction between pedestrians and all these horse-drawn carriages. And these cars came barreling in and everybody had to get out of the way. It was a tremendous backlash. Well, what happened? We redesigned the streets. Now we had lanes. Now we have double yellow lines down the middle. These are the kinds of accommodations which are going to facilitate what is a tremendous economic and ethical obligation that we have to try to use this to stop the carnage and all the accidents and to generate more wealth for society. And we're going to do that through the infrastructure.
I think more generally what we're seeing here is machines and automation are going to change the world. We've begun to talk about autonomous vehicles, but there are other types of robots, surgical robots, and personal and service robots, robots that might rescue people, drones, all kinds of machines are going to be out there. And as Whitfield Diffie was saying in the cryptographers panel today, the interaction between humans and machines is like the big issue of the next set of decades. We're seeing that beginning with autonomous vehicles, but it's just going to magnify in many, many other contexts.
So let me just, in our concluding minutes, just again try to shift to what kind of lessons would you like to impart to this crowd of cybersecurity that we've learned from thinking about autonomous cars and automation? What kinds of things, maybe some advice? So if we change the scenario to there's a bunch of cybersecurity folks in DC and we want to give them some policy guidelines or something to think about, what would you, what's some advice based on what we have?
Yeah, as the general counsel of our hypothetical company, I would begin to say, think about legal issues very early on. When you're in the design phase, it's much easier to make decisions about potential features that might create liability and make some changes now rather than doing it at the end. But we have to think about, as enterprises or in any type of public policy discussion, think about compliance, whether what we're about to do, what we're about to make is legal, liability, what can we do to reduce our risk, and information governance, privacy, security, and how we manage records. We need to think about legal issues, and there is a role for law in the way that we design and roll out a product. If we can use legal advice to help guide us, we're going to reduce our risk.
I agree with Steve in your remark at the very beginning that this session is more about autonomous cars. It's really about any autonomous system. The reason why we're focused on autonomous cars is it's such a great visceral poster boy. Right? I mean, this autonomous car is a robot, one of the first robots to be integrated with society at any scale. So this is going to really set the tone for all of robotics and autonomous systems. And the big takeaway I would have is that what you're doing here isn't just creating a new tool or creating some algorithms. You're doing something more profoundly important, philosophically important, which is that AI is replacing human decision making. It's replacing not just human bodies, but human minds and decisions. And there's tremendous legal responsibility and ethical responsibility there. So an autonomous car, you know, if you're in an accident and you jerk the wheel around, okay, that's a bad accident, a bad reflex. You can be forgiven for that. But if a manufacturer pre-scripts the accident, right, if it says, well, if there's a big object here and a little object there, let's prefer to hit the little object, that looks more like premeditated homicide. Right? So that's no longer just a simple accident. So there's huge responsibility for manufacturers who take this decision-making capabilities from us humans and outsource it to machines. And I'm not clear that they're all aware of how profoundly important that work is.
So Jerry. Well, you asked the question about policymakers, really. And I think in this instance, the caution or the exhortation that I would give to policymakers on this is don't think of this as just kind of facilitating an economic and industrial thing and that, you know, Google writes memos and then they change the rules, which is what happened at the NHTSA, I got the right, anyway. There is a very important ethical responsibility which goes unstated, which is that these devices are going to make us wealthier. These devices, and I'm speaking broadly about autonomous robots, robots that are around us, are going to make us wealthier, they're going to make us safer, they're going to save lives, and how you do your work, it really now has a kind of ethical component and an ethical obligation in a way that just, you know, regulating the insurance industry does not.
And by the way, the benefit of saving a lot of lives doesn't release people from looking at these edge cases, these corner cases, right? That's doing ethics by math, by saying, hey, we could save 30,000 lives here. Don't worry about the few we sacrifice here. That's not how we really think about things. I mean, this is why civil society doesn't agree to, say, torture. All right. I mean, even torturing innocent people, by torturing an innocent person, we could save a lot of other lives. But we don't believe that the numbers tell the whole story. We could rush a life-saving cancer drug to market really quick if we cut corners on the human clinical trials, but we think that's bad. So just because there's a big benefit we're looking at doesn't mean you could cut corners on the ethics side.
So I would just like to add something to that, maybe answering my own question, which is that most of the AI, including some of the AI that will be used for driving cars, will happen in the cloud, and it'll be transmitted. Not all the AI in a self-driving car is going to happen inside the frame of the car. A lot of the awareness of the roads, traffic, other things will happen in the cloud. So AI is primarily a cloud event. And like a cloud event, it has a lot to do with data, a lot to do with security, a lot to do with information. And all those things, all those kinds of very large systems are susceptible to kind of the questions that we're asking, which is, where are the ethics? Who owns the information about yourself? Who is responsible for the information? And these questions, I think, are not going to be answered by any of us today. These are going to be kind of the long agenda that we're going to have of trying to answer them. But I do want to say one thing, which is, I think that as we try to wrestle with these and the ethics of it, and the ethics of giving those ethics to these systems, that will make us better ethically. Because I think right now we think that we are very good. Humans are really good at moral choices and ethicals, but I think we're really lousy at it. We're very inconsistent. We actually don't even know what we believe or think we believe. And part of what will happen as we try and tease out and understand to convey it, to articulate it, it actually will come back that we will become better by it. We'll realize where we were inconsistent, where we were not as empathetic as we should be. And as a society, I think this exercise of trying to train our systems to do so will make us better people, better humans.
Well, I think, Kevin, I would rephrase what you said by saying it will make us better people by pointing out to us what idiots we really are.
Yeah.
So,
right.
You know, that's a moral statement.
We were just talking about this at lunch today, and I mentioned that you know, as AI replace humans, what we need is a soul-searching exercise.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I mean, in order to figure out if AI is supposed to replace a human, we got to first figure out what the human is and does, and right. What we should do.
Right, and I think there are many issues in cybersecurity that are reflected in the same general issues that any large data or AI system will have, which is, who's in, who's out, are you really you, what privileges do you have, are you operating for the good of the system or not? And then those decisions will make a huge difference to us all, and so they are very pertinent to everybody here and worth us participating in that kind of conversation about deciding what those ethics should be.
It's really an exciting time to be a professional in these fields. I think I can speak for all of us to say that we feel like we're doing the most important work we could possibly be doing at this time. And I hope that all of you, when you go back to your offices, when you get back home and when you go to work again, that you start looking at some of these issues that you might not have otherwise looked at day to day to say, maybe there's some ethical decisions that I need to make as part of my job, or maybe there's some legal aspects that I haven't looked at before. I encourage you to think about those types of issues when you go home.
Last words, Jerry?
Well, I think that in this instance, we're thinking about it wrong when we think about it's a car, but it's driverless. A car, I'd like to remind everybody, was a horseless carriage. It's a carriage, but it doesn't have the horse. Well, obviously, we have a completely different infrastructure today than we had when we had carriages that were driven by horses. So the way to think about this is not in a static form and replacing this one piece, but rather we're in the process of a major redesign of our transportation infrastructure in this case. But your point about the data is very important. It's going to come up in a lot of different contexts about who has it, who has rights to use it, how is it managed, and what are the threats that it occurs. So I would just leave you with one simple thought. The Borg is coming, and we will all be assimilated.
Yeah. Pat, last words.
I can't follow the Borg.
We all have been assimilated already. Thank you for your attention. I really appreciate it. And thank you for our guests.